The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
It is. And it's a Thursday. Welcome to it. Nicole Sandler here, coming to you live at NicoleSandler.com. Progressive Voices Network. We're also on Facebook Live. We are on Periscope. We are on Twitch. Alas, we are not on YouTube because, well, they suspended me. But we're working on it, still working on it. Regardless, lots of other ways to watch and listen. What a day, huh? What a week. I don't know if you've been watching the Republican convention. I have not. Well, I have in bits and pieces because that's about all I can take. And the disconnect from reality is stunning. But something else has happened over the last 24 hours or so, maybe 36 hours, that is inspiring. And, you know, I don't talk sports on this program very often, but every now and then I call in my favorite sports writer, sports commentator, Dave Zirin, who is the sports, I guess, editor at The Nation magazine and the host of the Edge of Sports podcast. You can find him at edgeofsports.com. Dave Zirin. Dave, thank you so much for jumping on with us today. It's been a long time, but I always appreciate your input.
No, I'm happy to be here. Thanks so much, Nicole.
So yesterday, right before I went on the air, I go on the air at 5 o'clock. I heard the news that, basketball players from Milwaukee were, you know, some were saying boycott, some were saying striking. Either way, they said they weren't going to play the game. And I guess it's playoff time. I'm so not a sports fan, but, they took a stand and said enough is enough already and walked off the court. Is that what happened yesterday?
No, they never left the locker room.
Oh.
It started with the Milwaukee Bucks. Milwaukee, of course, is a 45-minute drive to Kenosha. Mm-hmm. And they decided that as a team, without telling anybody else in the NBA, that they just could not play, that they could not walk out onto that court. People who've watched the NBA since they've been in this hermetically sealed COVID bubble in Orlando knows that Black Lives Matter is written on the court.
Mm-hmm.
They're wearing uniforms with slogans on the back. But for a lot of these players, the disconnect just became too great between the fact that they were having this sort of, you know, somewhat vapid sloganeering, the gap between that and the reality that Jacob Blake was shot 7 times in the back in Kenosha. And so they just felt like, you know, several of the players said, you know, this has to be more than just sloganeering. Like, we actually have to put ourselves out there. And so what they did was they went on strike. And I think strike is the correct word because they were withdrawing their labor mm-hmm. from a process that needs their labor to survive economically.
Most definitely.
So it started with the Bucks.
Right.
And then it became like this incredible cascade where I could barely keep up with the news. Then it became other NBA teams said, well, we're not going to play tonight either. Then it reached Major League Baseball, which is unbelievable given the conservatism of Major League Baseball, starting again with the Brewers, the team in Milwaukee. Then the WNBA said, well, we're not going to play. And the WNBA has been a leading ideological force on using sports as a space to speak up for Black lives. Then you saw it hit Major League Soccer. Then you saw Naomi Osaka, uh-huh. once the number one tennis player in the world, say she wasn't going to play in her tournament the next day. So all of these things work together to create something that actually, I think, profoundly overshadowed the gaslighting of the RNC.
Oh.
Because it gave people a sense of hope as opposed to a sense of despair.
Definitely. I mean, it gave us something to hold on to and say, this is reality. This is life. What's going on with the RNC is just otherworldly in many ways. And, you know, it's so interesting to see the turnaround with the owners and the commissioners and the upper echelon, I guess, of sports, the non-athlete part of the sports world, who were so against Colin Kaepernick when he started kneeling. What was it, just 4 years ago that he...
Yeah, almost 4 years to the day.
Right. And the turnaround after, I guess it was after George Floyd, that all of a sudden they realized, the owners and the commissioners and Roger Goodell and everyone else, oh, maybe we were wrong. Is that what happened? Or did they just see public sentiment changing on them and they realized they need to come to the party?
I mean, some of it definitely was public sentiment, but it was also just the assertion of the voice and power of the players themselves. I mean, there is no sport without the players. Mm-mm. And that's something that's been an accepted truth in the NBA for some time. And the NBA, they speak about there being player power, mm-hmm. and it being a player-centered league. And players have been, you know, used their platform to speak about politics, particularly around racist police violence for quite a few years. I mean, since 2014, or if you want to go back to, you know, the wannabe police officer, George Zimmerman, ugh. Killing Trayvon Martin.
Yep.
I mean, it goes back even longer than that of NBA players speaking up and speaking out. But what's been so interesting about this is that one could almost expect that this would be the NBA and the WNBA's response. What's, you know, them speaking out, them saying something. What's different is the withdrawing of their labor. That's a huge difference. And what's different is the fact how quickly it entered other sports.
Yeah.
The NHL is not going to be playing tonight.
Really?
And that's a sport that has very few black players in the NHL. There are black players in the NHL, but they're very few.
Mm-hmm.
But the NHL, I mean, even they're feeling it. The players are feeling it. I mean, it's this idea that, you know, the society that we live in is not functioning. And if it's not functioning, why should there be games? Why should there be play?
Exactly.
And that's something that's hitting these players in a very, very sincere way.
Right.
But if I could just say one other thing, Nicole.
Please.
Is that the other thing that this has done that I've seen is that it's also been like an electric cattle prod on people in the labor movement. Because what they're showing, you know, we had the largest protests in the history of the United States after the murder of George Floyd. And not a lot changed.
No.
You know, we had streets that have been on fire. Not a lot has changed. Instead, we get law and order rhetoric from the administration. And I mean, and I think a callous disregard for people's lives. But what the players did was put the question of labor at the center of how we can resist racial violence. And I can say this from speaking to people last night, I was working the phones. This is now a topic of conversation in unions around the country that have been dormant. Teachers, postal workers, flight attendants, that they're now saying, well, if the athletes can do this, where are we?
Right. And this, you know, I don't believe much of the violence or looting or fire setting is coming from the protesters. I believe 99.5% of the people who are out there protesting are doing it peacefully. I think that there are agents provocateur who are going out there trying to ramp up the chaos, because that's, you heard them say it yesterday, last night, and today, that they believe that, you know, rioting in the streets helps Donald Trump. How? I don't understand. I don't see how it helps anyone, but this is what they want more of. So this is, it's all the more important that we protest peacefully and that people like these athletes get up and take a stand the way they are. This
I agree with you.
You write at The Nation, at Dave Zirin, the Milwaukee Bucks and Brewers strike for racial justice. And then the subtitle says, the decision by the Bucks and Brewers to sit out their games is unprecedented. And it is. This is history making. I know you and I spoke about what happened at the 1968 Olympics in Mexico City when Tommy Smith and John Carlos raised their fist, and we talked about it, you know, a few years ago on whatever anniversary it was. And that has stayed with us. That has resonated through the years, through the decades. This action by the Milwaukee Bucks and Brewers and all the other athletes, this is going to go down in the history books, isn't it?
Oh, I think it is. I mean, because it's without precedent. And part of the thing about it being without precedent is that we don't really have a roadmap for knowing where this is going to go from here. And a lot of it is frankly going to depend what happens in the streets of this country more than the agency of individual athletes. So I don't know where this goes, but I do know, to speak to what you said, that while there is a very faint tradition of athletes refusing to play in protest of racism, and I'm talking about like a game here and there in the 1960s, college athletes who refused to play against BYU when they had formal racist policies in the Mormon church until I believe 1977, you would see boycotts. So this is something that's been there in the history of sports, but it's nothing like what we saw yesterday.
No.
In terms of, you know, the number of players, in terms of it being the playoffs, in terms of the way it's spread from league to league to league. And some of that is people's outrage. Some of that is social media, frankly, and the ability for this news to get out there quickly and for people to then respond to that. So a lot of factors are at play, but this is such a, and some of it also is the pandemic. I mean, that can't be left out of this, not only because of the frustrations that it leads people to, but the NBA players have been playing in this kind of COVID bubble in Orlando. And this bubble means that they're all living, them and the WNBA players, in this kind of dorm environment. They're in very close quarters with each other. There's a lot of downtime. There's a lot of boredom. There's a lot of homesickness.
I bet.
You know, people aren't, you know, your family can't be in there with you. Wow. Your kids can't be in there with you. And because of that, there's been an opportunity to really talk with one another about what is happening in this country.
Right.
So the pandemic is part of this story.
I'm sure it is. So yesterday afternoon, or this morning, I was reading that the Los Angeles Lakers and the Clippers both voted to boycott the rest of the season. And there was talk of that. But then I heard today that that's not happening, that they are going to play again. What happened?
Yeah, I mean, it was just the Lakers and the Clippers.
Okay.
Now, obviously, those are two very powerful teams coming out of Los Angeles. They're both two of the best teams. But it was really the Lakers and the Clippers on one side and then the rest of the league on the other that wanted to figure out a way that they could finish the season. Now, there was another meeting today that with the NBA Board of Governors, that's like the leading franchise owners. And while I don't know the content of what was said in that meeting, enough was said in terms of commitments from NBA franchise owners, these very connected billionaires, about what they would do to try to join this fight or support it, to at least make the players feel like they could move on. And I was asked earlier today on a different show if I thought the players made the right decision in deciding to come back. And I'm not trying to be wishy-washy on this. I really believe that there was not a wrong decision that they could make. If they had decided that they were not going to play any longer for the rest of this season, then that would have been one hell of a statement about the level of crisis that we find ourselves in.
Yep.
The fact that they're continuing to play, it continues to give them a spotlight. It continues to give them a platform, and it continues to give them the very viable threat that they could pull out again.
Sure.
If things go sour in this country, as I mean, I don't see how they're not going to, given the tenor of this administration and the kind of things that they're encouraging in the streets of this country.
Exactly. Exactly. So let me ask you one more question, somewhat related, because this, the idea of athletes protesting this police brutality aimed at African Americans, this epidemic, it's another epidemic that we're living under. Colin Kaepernick, 4 years ago, he was blackballed by the NFL. Now all of a sudden Roger Goodell says, oh, some team should hire him. Is any team going to hire him? Is he ever going to play football again?
I have serious doubts that he'll ever play again. I mean, we're talking about going on three seasons where he hasn't played. That's a long time. He still has the physical skills. I know that he works out 6 days a week.
Wow.
So he's there to be signed. He's better than a ton of the quarterbacks in the NFL, but that's been true for several years.
Uh-huh.
And I still believe that NFL owners believe that Colin Kaepernick has more value as a kind of ghost story to scare other players to stay in line than he does as a player on a team. Now, let's see if that calculus shifts. given everything that's happened over the last 48 hours. Because, I mean, I got to be honest with you, there's nothing that could happen at this point that would surprise me.
No.
I mean, I'm hearing that hockey is not going to play for racial justice. Nothing's going to shock me.
I hear you. Now, LeBron James seems to be one who stepped out. Obviously, he's one of the biggest names in sports today, if my information is correct. They're not going to try to make an example of him like they did with Colin Kaepernick. One, because I think attitudes have changed, but two, he's too much of a moneymaker for them. They wouldn't even risk that. Jared Kushner this morning said he was going to speak with LeBron James. Do you know if that happened or if it is happening?
No, I have no idea if that happened. I can't imagine it was high on LeBron James's list of things to do. I mean, Jared Kushner is not fit to shine LeBron James's shoes, but I don't think he has the capacity for manual labor, so maybe that's not even fair to say.
I think you're right. Dave Zirin, thank you for what is, I'm sure, a very, very busy day for you. I really appreciate you jumping on with us. It's great to see you. Great to talk to you.
Great to see you as well. Thanks, Nicole.
Thank you so much. All right, you take care. Have a good day, and thank you to these athletes who are doing this. This is an awesome day. This is the perfect way for them to respond. And yes, it does give us some hope in the face of all this insanity we're living in.
Exactly.
All right. Thanks. Bye, Dave. And there he goes. Dave Zirin of The Nation. You find him at edgeofsports.com for his podcast and everything else. He's a good guy. I've been talking to Dave. He's been, for someone who doesn't know anything about sports, except, her husband was a sports agent. He has been so generous of his time with me and with this show, so I really appreciate it. I'll link to his piece at The Nation on my blog at NicoleSandler.com, where I post today's show. So here we are. That's happening. And the RNC is going on, and what a mess. When I said at the beginning that I wasn't watching it, I'll tell you, I didn't watch much of it last night because, honestly, there was nobody I wanted to see. I did happen to turn it on for a couple of seconds and heard Kellyanne Conway. We wonder about Donald Trump saying the quiet parts out loud because it seems old Kellyanne did just that last night.
Also noticed there was a quote today from a restaurateur in Wisconsin saying, "Are you protesters trying to get Donald Trump reelected? He knows full stop." Yeah. And I guess Mayor Pete knows full stop that the more chaos and anarchy and vandalism and violence reigns, the better it is for the very clear choice on who's best on public safety and law and order.
Oh my God. No, I guess that wasn't during her RNC speech because I don't even know what she was talking about. But this was on a TV interview where she said, the more chaos and violence on the streets, the better it is for Donald Trump. Unbelievable. Well, Joe Biden decided to speak up today. He called into both Andrea Mitchell's show on MSNBC and to Anderson Cooper on CNN. And with Anderson Cooper, Joe Biden addressed that very issue. Here's what they said.
The vice president echoed the president last night by telling Americans that they would not be safe in Joe Biden's America.
Well, look, if you think about it, Donald Trump saying you're not going to be safe in Joe Biden's America, while all the video being played is being played in Donald Trump's America.
Yeah.
Kellyanne Conway came out and was very, very blunt about it today. I think I have a quote here. She said, "The more chaos and anarchy and vandalism, the more violence equals a better the choice for a very, excuse me, better for a very clear choice."
Okay.
These guys are rooting for violence. That's what it's all about. To prove that you should be scared of Joe Biden, they're pointing to what's happening in Donald Trump's America. I made it clear from the beginning that there's no place for violence or looting or burning. And when I spoke with Jacob Blake's mother, Julia, you guys played her on the air. She's saying, "That's not who we are. That's not who our family is. That's not who Jacob is. Don't do it." And so, he continues to root for violence. It's, the country will be substantially safer when he is no longer in office. And, I'm going to work to calm the tensions and root out systemic racism. I'm going to lead.
Okay.
You think he's actually rooting for violence, that he wants violence because it allows him to claim a law and order mantle?
Sure. And because it takes everybody's eye off the ball. want to talk about safety, look at the biggest safety issue in the nation, COVID. You know, just yesterday we had 1,249 deaths. Over the 7-day period, we've averaged 1,000 deaths a day. Now, that is more than the five largest countries in Europe. A combined population, we are a combined population bigger than us. You know how many they've had? 77 deaths a day. He has been incompetent in the way in which he's dealt with this. And not only that, you know, he talks about taking away, he's still in court trying to get rid of the Affordable Care Act. Going to take 100 million people with pre-existing conditions and move them in a direction where they can't get coverage. Coverage is going to be lost for so many.
All right, so then now they moved, obviously, moved on to a different subject. But that's what it is. This was Mike Pence. Sorry, only 10 seconds of Mike Pence. But last night in his official whatever it was at the RNC.
The hard truth is, you won't be safe in Joe Biden's America.
Really? And the crowd.
Under President
Trump. The crowd goes, well, there's no crowd there. Do you feel safe in Donald Trump's America? I don't know about you, but I feel a whole lot safer in Joe Biden's America than I do in Donald Trump's America. Ugh. All right, so today's Thursday. We sort of got switched around because we had Dave Zirin on right at the top. But Howie Klein is coming up in just a few minutes. Stuff to talk with him about, you know, just the insanity of the RNC, which, by the way, ends tonight. And I'm seeing all kinds of weird stuff on Twitter. I saw Frank Figluzzi, who is a former FBI guy, who I don't know if he's joking. You know, that's the problem with the internet. You can't see smiles or read nuance, but he tweeted something to the effect of, I hear Donald Trump is going to bring out Barack Obama's original Kenyan birth certificate tonight. Now, normally I'd laugh, right? But we're talking about Donald Trump here. Donald Trump, who is batshit crazy, who would do something like that. And the previews that we've gotten of his speech say that he is going full tilt on Joe Biden tonight. So if nothing else, it'll be interesting if you can stomach it. I say have some Pepto-Bismol ready and what we used to call a vomit pot. You know, that's just it's a pot or a giant bowl into which you can puke if the need arises. All right. All right. Howie Klein's coming up. Let's take a quick break for our friends at the Progressive Voices Network to take care of some business. And we will be right back on the Nicole Sandler Show. Don't go away. So while they're in commercials, I thought we would take this opportunity for a funny, because we, you know, could all use a laugh now and then. I'm torn between this new one from Founder Singh and one from a guy who, you know, this is his first video. I like the underdog. So let's do the guy which, you know, who doesn't normally produce videos. What is his name? I think I wrote it down here. Did I? His name is Don for Blues on YouTube. Don, like Trump. Don number 4 Blues. And he decided to parody a song that I love. It takes us back to the 90s for Beck and Beck's biggest or first hit, I guess I should say, Where It's At. You know that song? I got 2 turntables and a microphone. Where It's At. All right, just to give you a point of reference. Take it away, Don for Blues. Here we go.
There's a global pandemic and it's out of control. And it makes no difference if you're young or you're old. You can't stay locked up with the people you know. Better do what's right or face dying alone. Walking around asymptomatic, the ICU is gonna overflow. Can't make no plans, so just wash your hands and just wash your hands.
Wear your mask,
or the ICU's gonna overflow.
Wear your mask,
Gotta get this virus under control.
Wear your mask.
All the ICU is gonna overflow.
Wear your mask.
All lives matter. That's how we roll.
That was a big mistake.
Strap one on, Trump. You ain't the Lone Ranger. Lead by example. Don't put us in danger. I got a condition, immunocompromised. I don't want to see your mouth, just your lying eyes. Want to be a gambler? Want to fly to Rome? Don't go to a funeral unless it's your own. The time is now. We all part of the herd. Stop spreading the virus. Just spread the word.
Wear your mask.
Or the ICU's gonna overflow.
Wear your mask.
Gotta get this virus under control.
What about those idiots that wear it the wrong way? Put the mask on, baby.
There's a global pandemic and it's out of control. And it makes no difference if you're young or you're old. You can stay locked up with the people you know. Better do what's right or face dying alone. Walking around asymptomatic. The ICU's gonna overflow. Can't make no plans, so just wash your hands and just wash your hand.
Wear your mask.
Or the ICU's gonna overflow.
Wear your mask.
Better wear one now, cause that's where it's at.
I don't have to wear a mask. This is a social conspiracy. This is social regulation.
Overwhelming evidence shows that face coverings are an effective way of slowing the spread of COVID-19.
You are infringing on my freedom. You have no right to do that. I have my rights.
The Progressive Voices Network.
Ah, all right, we are back. A little bit of a comedy respite, as it were, but as I said yesterday, to cleanse the palate, so to speak. So tonight, again, I guess Ivanka is going to speak. And what else? Who else? Oh, Donald Trump. I don't know who else, because I try not to pay too much attention, because frankly, the gaslighting is really getting to me. So this weekend, I think everyone's going to need to regroup, unplug, get that crap noise out of their heads. And two things. One, find something to occupy your mind that is not Donald Trump. And two, push back against their gaslighting, because it's going to come on very, very strong tonight. Yes. And register to vote. Back to Nicole. It's House of Roberts in the chat room at NicoleSandler.com monitors the Progressive Voices stream for me. Thank you, House of Roberts. So I know that, yes, they're running commercials, and they did. So glad it all works. And they ran a register to vote promo, although I think it's a little late to register. Now the promos should be to get out the vote, because it's all well and good if you registered. It's not so great if you don't vote. So please vote, because I don't know about you, but if by some chance Donald Trump is able to eke out another win, all bets are off. I look at what he's done in this first term. Can you imagine his second term, when he's got, look, checks and balances don't work with this guy, because he does not recognize the legitimacy of Congress to perform oversight. He doesn't recognize that anybody else has power but him, because he thinks he's a dictator. He thinks he is, you know, an emperor. He thinks he is Donald Putin. And he's going to be president for life, and we need to make sure that doesn't happen. And, you know, it's for that reason that I spend so much time talking about elections, interviewing candidates, talking to people like Howie Klein, who helps find great progressive candidates. And raises money for them to get them elected so we can change the course of our government. I will say it again, and I know I piss off some listeners when I say this. Joe Biden was not my first choice. He was not my fifth choice, but he is the nominee. Kamala Harris did a little press conference today. She's going to be with him. I think they will surround themselves, hopefully, with decent people, and we can push them from the left, which is what we will do. But first, we got to get them in office. So with that, let's get Howie on the line, shall we? Is anyone mixing up the Dirty Debbies today?
Are you a multinational corporation hungry for a treat? Well, come on down to Schmucky Chucky's, where you'll personally be seated by Chuck Schumer himself.
So many dishes, and they're all fresh.
You're gonna love our Blue Dog special, the Dino Burger, because we say so.
A good hamburger and french fries.
And every burger comes with a side order of...
grits. I love grits. I love anything with corn. It's corn.
All for only $50,000. Wash it all down with a Dirty Debbie.
9/10 water, 1/10 orange juice. After a week or two, you drink this, it's 200 calories and it's acetic.
And wipe your mouth with a tissue print of Glass-Steagall. For dessert, try our DNC tarts.
Little cookies, tell the quality of that.
Most restaurants give you a mint, but at Schmucky Chucky's, you get complimentary.
Sweet and low.
Sweet and low.
Who picks up the tab for all this? Find out now with Howie Klein of DownWithTyranny.com on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh, hi, Howie Klein.
Hello, Nicole Sandler.
How are you?
I'm good, thank you.
Good.
Fine. And you also?
You know, hanging in there. It's weird being in this COVID bubble where I don't often leave my house. The only time I ever do go out is to go to the doctor. And actually, I had a doctor's appointment this morning because getting old really sucks. I've had this issue with my right hand, where at first I thought it was maybe carpal tunnel syndrome because I'm working on a computer all the time, but it was not that from research. And then my fear was, oh my God, I think I'm getting rheumatoid arthritis. So I went today to a rheumatologist. I don't know how to say it. And the good news is he doesn't think it is, but he's sending me for a ton of other tests. Again, I go out with my mask, my face shield, my gloves. my husband wants to wrap me in bubble wrap. Now I got to go out and have more blood drawn and x-rays and all kinds of stuff because getting old really sucks, but I guess it beats the alternative.
Right.
Yeah.
Funny enough, a friend of mine, who is working, she works in the finance industry, and they're considered essential.
Of course they are.
And she called me today, and she said, do you want to come out for dinner?
Ooh.
What? And I said, what?
Yeah.
I haven't been out for dinner since beginning of March.
Yeah, me either.
And she said, oh, so you're still not going out? I said, no, I'm still not going out. And then she told me something that was really odd. Like, she's very wealthy. She lives in Beverly Hills. And down the hill from her are just, they built a bunch of McMansions. They tore down, like, one, like, really old mansion.
Mm-hmm.
And they built, like, four or five McMansions where that one mansion had been.
Right.
And the people who live in some of them have fled L.A., and they went to, their country homes or to live with relatives. I don't know where they went, but they don't live there anymore. And they're renting those places out as Airbnb places.
Right.
And she said there are parties every night, like big parties. But yesterday, she was stuck in her house because there was a shooting. One person is dead and another person is going to die or is near death. And that happened in the party.
Oh, my God. Well, I did see something about house parties in the Hollywood Hills and how they're, Garcetti is, laying down the law. And I don't remember what the penalty was, but that apparently they were really cracking down on them. But I guess it's happening all over the place out there. Wow.
It is. And everywhere. I mean, they're in New York also. Yeah. A friend of mine told me that from the very beginning of this, that there were people who were having house parties. And we obviously we've seen them in the middle of the country as well. In Missouri, they've had house parties.
Yep.
And wherever they have these big parties, it, what follows in the wake is
cases
of COVID. And then some deaths. You probably know the word Sturgis, South Dakota.
Of course, and that's where the motorcycle thing was.
Because that's where they had the big motorcycle rally.
Mm-hmm.
And that was 2 weeks ago. And now we're starting to see the statistics coming in, not just from South Dakota, but there were people who came from all over the country, although predominantly from the Midwest. And in all of those states where they had large numbers of people going to that, there are outbreaks of COVID. And it's not just the people who went to, you know, you might say, well, I hope they get it and die. That would be cool, but it's not even correct.
No.
Because they then go back to their communities, and especially in Nebraska and in Wyoming and in Colorado. And then and some of these states are non-mask states, by the way, and they spread it widely.
Yeah.
I mean, very widely. And that's how you have a pandemic. That's exactly how it happens. And you talked about the penalties. Well, there are no penalties. There are no real penalties. I mean, the way that they've been trying to do it, because they don't want to start a war with people who are running around with weapons, is instead of the government cracking down in most states, including California, what they do is they make in the case of stores, for example, if you go in a store without a mask, you don't have to worry that the police are going to come and arrest you. That doesn't happen. Or fine you even. That doesn't happen. What they do is they tell the shopkeeper that it's your responsibility. You have to throw them out.
Oh, God. Right.
And that causes fights, and there have been some shootings and stabbings and deaths. This is being done wrong. I mean, this isn't how it's supposed to be. There should be a national policy. You know, COVID does not recognize state borders. There should be a national policy, and there should be, just as the way there was in many other countries, very, very, very strict adherence.
Like Italy, right?
You pay a fine.
Yeah.
You pay a very big fine.
Absolutely.
Enough of to discourage you from doing it again. And then the second time you pay a much bigger fine, and the third time you go to jail, where there's a very good chance you'll get very sick.
Right. Yeah. Well, you know, that's the thing. If you could say to somebody, you know what, do this, and you're assured to get sick, but we can't. And I keep reading story after story of these, you know, Trumpers who go, I thought it was a hoax until I got it and wound up in the ICU for 6 weeks, or I got it and my wife died. I no longer think it's a hoax. That's too late for people to, you know, get with the program here. It's frightening to me. I mean, just being out, when I'd see somebody out without a mask, I don't understand the irresponsibility, not only for your own personal safety, but to disregard what you could be passing on to people all around you. I just don't get it. Then again, I don't go out very much.
Yeah.
You know, I feel bad.
And nor do I. And when I do go out, I don't see people without masks. Maybe it's because of the neighborhood I live in. I don't know. But I'm not seeing it. I'm seeing people with masks.
Yeah, well, you're not in Florida. My daughter, who I feel so terrible for, I mean, she turned 21 in isolation with us, and she's still here with us, and you know, all her friends are going out, and she's like, I would, but then I can't, I don't want to bring it home to you and David, because you know, she's being responsible, but it's getting to her, as it would, I mean, as it gets to anybody. But can you imagine being 21 and stuck in the house with your old parents for 5 months?
It's pretty awful. And I think it's very common around the country. I think that is, you're seeing that a lot, and you're seeing the other thing a lot of people going out. I mean, I spoke to a really good friend of mine in Florida who I would expect more from, and he told me that he and his family go out to eat every night.
Oh, my God.
They go to a restaurant. I mean, and we don't have open restaurants in L.A. I mean, we have restaurants for takeout, but they want to eat on the street. You take out in it, or you have it delivered, and that's it.
Right. No, here
but
they
I don't
have.
Even that. I'm literally. I don't want to use the word afraid, although it's an appropriate word.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't use. I think we've had like maybe 5 deliveries since this whole thing started. We're making food.
Yeah,
I'm making
us
some
too.
Food right No.
Yeah, I've been cooking. We've talked about that. I still have to put up my recipe page because I've been getting into it. And, you know, the really sad thing is on the last week, at least I could watch the Democratic convention and not be totally sickened as I am watching this stuff this week. It ends tonight. Tonight is the final night of the Republican convention. And I found it quite interesting that three news stories greeted me when I awoke this morning. From the New York Times, the headline read, over 100 ex-staff members for John McCain endorsed Joe Biden. And then there were two stories from Politico. One reads, Romney 2012 staffers unite behind effort to elect Joe Biden. And then the other one says, more than 100 Bush, McCain, Romney alums go for Biden. So, you know, as on their last day, when Donald Trump is doing his big, you know, norm-breaking acceptance speech from the South Lawn of the White House, all of these, you know, major Republicans are coming out for his opponent. And then I read the story about how the U.S. Chamber of Commerce is poised to endorse nearly two dozen freshman House Democrats for re-election. The U.S. Chamber of Commerce, which was always an arm of the Republican Party. I know you're writing a post on this. This is a big deal, isn't it?
It is a big deal, but I mean, the Republicans are freaking out over it. But the reality is that the Chamber of Commerce has been endorsing some Democrats, never this
really?
Many, and never freshmen. So they haven't done it that way before. But they're doing it this way. But when you look at the list, the list is so conservative. The list of Democrats so conservative. These are exactly the kind of people that the Chamber of Commerce have always endorsed. They used to only have R's next to their name, but as the Republican Party has gone more in a fascist direction and away from sort of just mainstream conservatism, the gap is being filled by these Democrats. We shouldn't be happy about this, that the Chamber of Commerce is endorsing people like Elaine Luria from Virginia. These are terrible members of Congress. These are the people they're endorsing are the worst members of the worst Democrats in Congress.
Okay. I didn't get that.
Anyone good. Not a single good person is being endorsed. I take my word for it. I went through the whole list. I looked at it very, very closely. Every single one of them is rated an F.
Ooh.
And most of them are very, very, very low Fs. Not even like a high F. They're all low Fs.
Wow. See, and I didn't get that from where I read this art, and I don't even remember where I got it from now. And I obviously
Biden had a different point that he was making.
Uh-huh.
He's trying to make the point, and I'm assuming that's what you read, was Alex's piece. Alex is very good. He's one of the really good political journalists. What he's trying to say is that his story wasn't about Democrats. It was, although obviously it was based on the fact that the chamber was going to endorse all these Democrats, but what his story was about was about how the Republicans are freaking out over it and how angry they are and how, you know, there are some members of the chamber who are, you know, hardcore Republicans, obviously, and they're flipping out as well. So that's what Alex was writing about, and what he ignored was, not that he would probably ever do this anyway, but what he ignored was the which Democrats. That isn't what he cared about.
Right.
And what I did is I just went on from there to talk about who the DCCC is endorsing. And when you look at, you know, if you take the list of the new Dems, you know, that's the Wall Street-owned part of the Democratic Party, basically the Republican wing of the Democratic
Right.
Party. And when you look at that, and then you compare it with their endorsement list. You take their endorsement list and then you compare it to the DCCC's endorsement list. The DCCC, by the way, their endorsement list is the Red to Blue program, the one that Debbie Wasserman Schultz used to run.
Right.
And they're almost identical. I mean, Cherry Bustos has just ceded the gatekeepership of the Red to Blue program to the New Dems.
Really?
And the Blue Dogs. That all of their candidates are the ones who are getting endorsed. They toss a couple of bones to the progressives, just literally almost nothing. But all of the candidates that they're backing and excited about, and they're going to spend like as much as $4 and $5 million on each of them, they're all next year's crop of the kind of people who will be endorsed by the Chamber of Commerce. These are ultra, ultra conservatives. If you're a progressive, you would have recognized these people as Republicans just a few years ago. But now, and some of them were Republicans just a few years ago, but now they're so-called Democrats.
Wow. Wow.
You know, being endorsed by the Chamber of Commerce. You have to know, if the Chamber of Commerce endorses a Democrat, the Democrat has to be so horrible. I mean, they don't do it lightly. They vet their candidates very, very well.
Sure.
And you know, and they're very, very strict about it. And they, they're endorsing really, but of course, so are the New Dems very strict about it. And that's the kind of garbage candidates that they're endorsing.
Wow. You know, and I guess you're right. That was the article that I read because I just pulled it up. And yes, he did not mention anyone by name. So, of course, I guess my wishful thinking got me thinking that maybe they're, you know, the Chamber of Commerce is trying to hedge their bets and
not at all. One of them is the exact bottom of the barrel. You just go to the very bottom of you know, who votes with the Republicans the most, who is the most anti-progressive. You just go to that list on Progressive Punch, say, that's where I go, and you look at the list of from the bottom up, you get to the whole bottom. That's who they're endorsing.
Well, let's, for a second, Howie, if we can do this. You know, we're getting close to the end of primary season. I guess there's a couple more. In fact, on, where is it? On the September 1st is that Massachusetts primary. I guess this past Tuesday was Oklahoma. I don't know if there was anything there, and maybe there's a few left.
No,
but
Oklahoma had happened earlier.
Oh, really? Okay, then I'm wrong. But we're getting close to the end. So now we need to look at a number of Blue America endorsed real progressives won their primaries. And so we have some really great races to look at. Marie Newman in Chicago, Jamal Bowman, who beat Elliot Engel, Kara Eastman in Nebraska, Cori Bush, Adam Christensen. Who am I leaving out? What other great progressives won their races that are now going into the general that we need to start, continue sounding the alarm on to let people know how good they are?
Right. Well, there are quite a few of them in both the both federally and also, and people tend to leave this out,
right.
State legislative
yes.
were extremely important.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a lot of like really, really good wins there. But since you asked about Congress first, let me just say that the ones that we're going to be looking at during, you know, to help to win against Republicans in November,
mm-hmm.
you know, I won't name the ones that you've already talked about. We've got Audrey Denny in Northern California, who's an incredible Bernie-crat and is running against a hardcore Trump Republican.
Uh-huh.
We have Dolio, and you should have Beth on your show.
Beth,
I think
Dolio?
You two would love each other.
Okay,
but her name is spelled with a G, so it would be like as though it was Doglio, but the G is silent, so it's Dolio.
Okay,
she's up in Washington State, and
okay.
she's running. She, you know, remember that's another state that has the situation where it's very common to have Democrat versus Democrat.
The jungle primary thing.
Yeah. Right, so that's what this race is. She's up against a extremely right-wing Democrat, corrupt to the core, and by the way, endorsed by the New Dems.
Of course.
And of course, you already mentioned Kara Eastman.
Kara Eastman.
We have a really good Democrat in Missouri who's running against Jason Smith. Jason Smith is one of the worst Republicans in Congress, and Kathy Ellis, this Democrat who's running against him in southeastern Missouri, it's the toughest race that Blue America is involved with. Anyone would say it's an impossible race, but she's running a good race, and we'll just have to see. Nothing's impossible when Trump's at the top of the ticket. John Hoadley, on the other hand, is most likely going to win. He's really, really good. He's in southwest Michigan. He won his primary, and now he's taking on Fred Upton,
who inherited, that's a biggie.
Millions and millions of dollars from the Whirlpool family. He's one of the offspring of that.
Wow.
And he's never worked a day in his life and doesn't know anything about what work is. And just as, you know, a Trump enabler, just sitting there and having a nice life. Kathy Kunkel in West Virginia. This Nate McMurray, who has a very, very exciting race. You know Nate, right?
Yes, he's been on the show. He was on with us. He's in upstate New York, right?
Exactly. Between the area between Rochester and Washington and Buffalo.
Right.
So neither city, but the suburbs of suburbs of Buffalo, and then all that rural area in between and south of it. And he's running a very, very, very lively race. No help from the DCCC, even though he came within, you know, just a few votes of winning last time. The DTrip doesn't want someone like him. He's way too progressive for them. You know, he's all about working families, and they don't like hearing that. They want people who are all about corporate donors.
Of course, right.
Julie Oliver and Mike Siegel, both in the Central Texas area, both have pieces of Austin, and they are both, it looks to me like they can both win.
Really?
Mike, I don't want to say he's a sure thing, there's no sure things, but he's really, really doing well. And Julie's an incredible campaigner. She did well last time. She's running again. I think we have a good shot there. Liam O'Mara.
In California, he was on with me when you were on vacation, and he was great. And actually, he's going to come back on again in a few weeks in the middle of September, where I already have a thing set up with him. He's an interesting guy, really fascinating man, Liam O'Mara.
Very, very smart. He's smart as a whip. And the last of the congressional candidates that we have running in November is J.D. Shulton in Iowa.
Ah, yes.
You know, I was looking, by the way, at the voting records of the two DCCC recruits from 2018, and the voting records are so horrible of those two that it's like I'm thinking, wow, what did we get? We got like two schlemiels with D's next to their name, and now they both have F's next to their name, and they're just terrible. They're just absolutely terrible. They vote horribly. Their instincts are horrible. They influence their colleagues to vote badly. They're always crying and whining that if the Democrats do this and the Democrats do that, they're going to not get their seats. They won't win their seats again. I wish they didn't win their seats. I literally want them to lose. That's how bad they are. But, you know, they're up in November against Republicans. And, you know, you look at the two and you say, well, the Republican is much worse. Yes, the Republican is much worse. You can't deny it.
Right.
But these two will vomit.
Well, that's sad. And Jerry Bustos is her role as the head of the DCCC ends with this election. I guess when the next Congress comes in, what?
I don't think so.
No,
I doubt it.
Oh.
The Democrats do really well, and she will be given all the credit, although she has nothing whatsoever to do with the credit.
Right.
If the credit is the Democrats get 100, not 100 seats, but you know they are great at 100, she gets zero. She has no credit whatsoever. She has done nothing except hold back the number of Democrats who can win. But she will get all of the credit, and they'll ask her to run the DCCC for another 2 years.
Oh, God. And Nancy Pelosi, is she going to run for Speaker again?
I don't know. I'm trying to remember what the deal was. I thought the deal was she would walk away, you know,
after one more term. That's what I thought.
But now I think she wants another one. I think, but I don't know for sure. We'll see. You know, from everyone I know in San Francisco politics, they're all telling me the same thing, which is she's trying to set it up for Christine, her daughter,
right? I've heard that too.
To come and get the seat. Now, the thing about this that's unfortunate is that Christine is really good.
Yeah.
As Pelosi was at one time as well.
Right.
I know Christine.
I do too. I've interviewed her. I agree.
She's a good person. But, you know, I just don't believe in dynasties.
Right.
You know, and I don't like to make an exception for friends of mine.
I hear you. No, but she is good. And I met her at a Netroots Nation some years ago, and she's been on the show a few times. And she's good. And I've fought with her. I fought with her over Nancy taking impeachment off the table for W before she ever even got the speaker gavel. And, you know, she played with me. I mean, she didn't take offense and allowed me to push back and argue with her. So she won brownie points in my book for that. But no, you're right. Dynasty are not good, and you know, all you have to do is look at the Trump family. Oh my God! oh my God!
Hopefully, we'll have the last time we'll look at them will be when they're leaving the White House in January.
I hope so. Now, Howie, I know you're not watching the Republican convention, but I'm guessing you've seen some of the clips. Kimberly Guilfoyle, did you see her?
Yes. What, do you want to talk about cocaine now? Or guess which drug she was on?
Well, yeah, both of them. I mean, obviously she and Don Jr. were on something. I don't understand. But you're from San Francisco. Do you know what the story is with her? She used to be married to Gavin Newsom. How does that happen?
Gavin Newsom makes complete sense to me.
That's really? Okay.
Kind of Democrat he is.
Yeah. But he, I guess he, so he was, you know, he's obviously more essential, and she, I guess, went more batshit crazy to the right. I just don't understand anything about this woman, and she kind of fascinates me. Yeah,
People who were, I think it was his campaign manager, said the other day that, you know, that's how she was when
she was married to him.
He says it was no different.
Wow. I just don't get it. And then now she's with Don Jr. By the way, I learned, not that I have any problem with it, but she's older than Melania. Sorry. I screw up her name.
That's great.
Yeah.
I love it.
And tonight it's going to be like the train wreck. I don't want to watch it, but for my job, I guess I have to. And just to be prepared to see, the gaslighting has been so over the top. That it makes me worry about parts of this country that believe him, that buy into this stuff, that are taking their, you know, law and order nonsense. You know, you heard what's her name, Kellyanne Conway, basically today said the more violence and chaos there is in the streets, the better it is for Trump's reelection. Does that, I mean, that scares the hell out of me.
Well, I don't think it's new to you, though,
no,
right?
No,
I
mean, not at all. But the fact that they're saying this stuff out loud, and people, look, the 17-year-old who shot three in Kenosha the other day, they're making him out to be some kind of folk hero. Ann Coulter, of all people, said, I want him as my president. There's a GoFundMe account raising money for him because they think he's a hero.
Well, you know, unfortunately, that's, our country is like very, very, very wounded. And I don't know how anyone is going to put it back. I don't know how, I don't know that there's someone who exists who could.
No. It is scary. And we're so broken again with the COVID and Trump. And I mean, it's like, what else can they throw at us? And, oh, you know, two hurricanes hitting at once. Thankfully, one of them petered out. But, you know, it's, I'm just waiting for the locusts to descend, which is, I guess that's next.
Let's hope
not. Yeah, let's hope not. It's right. Howie Klein. All right. Well, I'm going to let you go. We're getting to the end of the hour. Tomorrow, actually, I have Rick Perlstein on the show. And
I love Rick. Please say hello for me.
I definitely will. He's great. And I feel guilty that I've not made it through his book. But I don't know if you've seen Reaganland, but I've got it here. I'm holding it up for the camera. It's about 1,000 pages long. And but Rick Perlstein is fascinating. And so this, he says, is his fourth and final book in the foursome about the rise of conservatism in America. And it's interesting that he ends it with the election of Ronald Reagan. Do you think that was the end of the rise of conservatism?
I think it went, Ronald Reagan was, I think, the beginning of fascism in America.
Uh-huh.
So some people might say that he was the end of conservatism. I can understand that. But I think that that was the beginning of the fascist movement.
Interesting.
The Republican Party has been taken over by the fascists.
Oh, and it is. It is fascism on the rise, without a doubt. I mean, this would be a good time to, I don't know, go back and read the history of, you know, pre-World War II and the rise of Hitler and Mussolini and all those people, because there are so many parallels. It's just frightening.
Yep.
And that some people are, you know, latching on to it is what scares me. But I don't know. The inner optimist in me wants to say good will prevail. And then the inner pessimist says, we're so fucked. We're just really
right.
fucked.
Well, especially if you're going to be talking about that kid who went shooting and how they're now lionizing
yes.
him. What is that going to do? It's going to encourage other weak-minded people to do something similar.
You're right. On that note, Howie Klein, as always, thank you. Have a great weekend, and I'll see you next week.
Yes, good to talk to you.
Okay, you too, bye. And you, I'll see you tomorrow with Rick Perlstein. Have a good one, bye.